Good morning, Class 6. Today we will finish the chapter What Books and Burials Tell Us. Before we proceed, let's do a quick revision of what we have studied in the previous two classes. We have talked about one of the oldest books in the world, that is Rig Veda. There are four Vedas, the Rig Veda, Sam Veda, Yajur Veda and Athar Veda. Rig Veda is the oldest one. It was written in 3005 years, like almost 3005 years ago. It includes lot of hymns or suktas which were written in praise of gods and goddesses. And when it was written, it was specially written in context to the gods like Agni, the god of fire, Indra, a warrior god, and Soma, a plant from which a special drink was prepared. These hymns were composed by the rishis. And in that era, there was the concept of writing was not introduced. So people learned by listening. So priests, they taught their students, recited, and that was the way they memorized each word, each syllables. And that was the way it was memorized by the students. So you can understand that how difficult it would have been because they didn't have any book to refer to. Then we have talked about Sanskrit in context to other languages. You can say that Sanskrit is a part of language which is known as Indo-European. And they have told us here that there are certain other languages like Assamese, Gujarati, Hindi, Kashmiri and Sindhi. Asian languages such as Persian and many European languages such as English, French, German, Greek, they belong to the family, and that family they called it a family because there are few words which are common in all the languages with slight difference in their pronunciation. Then we have talked about how historians study the Rig Veda. So just to get the information, the historians, the archaeologists, they have studied the Rig Veda or the sources which they got from that era. Here we have talked about the conversation or the dialogue between Vishwamitra and two rivers whom he has referred by different names. At one place he has called them as his sisters. At one place he has called them as cows, as horse and cows. These and the rivers were, you have to tell me the name of the rivers. Yes, that's right. They were from Punjab. And okay, fine, that's correct. So then we have talked about why cattle, horses and chariots. Now you can understand that Vishwamitra has referred these rivers as cows and horses. That means these animals were given lot of respect in that era. And then we have talked about these the horses were used in the chariots which were used for the battles, and what they did, they fought to capture the cattle. So cattle held lot of importance in that period. Then we have talked about the Raja, they had the people took part in the wars. They didn't get any, they were not part of any regular army, but they were assemblies where people met and discussed matters of war and peace, and there only they chose their leaders. So the leader had to be a very skillful warrior. Then we have talked about the words which describe people, like priests were called the Brahmins who performed various rituals. And then we have talked about Rajas who were not the ones who were, they didn't have so much of knowledge, but then, and they were not similar to the Rajas which we have studied or will be studying in the later period. They didn't have any palace or armies, and nor did they collected any taxes. Then we have talked about Silent Sentinels, the story of the megaliths. So megaliths were, from the name it is very clear, mega means huge or big stones, and they were arranged in such a way to mark the burial sites. Now, when these burial sites have been excavated, the historians have found that they were different. So that means maybe there was some demarcation in the social strata. Some people had more utensils and more things in the burial. Maybe they felt that at one point of time they might get up and they will need those things. And if the person belonged to the lower strata, the number of things which were kept were decreased. So all these burials have some common features. That is, the dead was buried with the pots, black and red ware. Then we have studied that at certain places, there was some burial sites were fixed for particular family. They had had one entrance there, and when a person from that family died, he or she was buried there itself in the same burial site. Okay, now we have to continue. A special burial at Inamgaon. Find Inamgaon on map 2. It is a site on the river Gode, a tributary of the Bhima. It was occupied between 3600 and 2700 years ago. Here, adults were generally buried in the ground, laid out straight with the head towards the north. Sometimes burial were within the houses. Vessels that probably contained food and water were placed with the dead. One man was found buried in a large four-legged clay jar in the courtyard of a five-roomed house, one of the largest houses of the site, at the site in the center of the settlement. This house also had a granary. The body was placed in a cross-legged position. So till now we have talked about the sites where these bodies were buried, but then the archaeologists have found a place, or like you can say that a person was buried inside the house, and that house was comparatively bigger than the houses which they have excavated. It had five rooms, and the person was buried in the, like you can see, buried four-legged clay jar in a courtyard. So this house had they had a granary where they stored the grains, and the body was placed in a cross-legged position. Do you think this was the body of a chief? Give reasons for your answer. So you have to think about it. Yes, we can say, because first of all, the house was comparatively bigger than the other houses. Then other people have their different burial sites. Here the body was buried inside the house. Then the presence of granary. Okay. What skeletal studies tell us? It is easy to make out the skeletons of a child from its small size. However, there are no major difference in the bones of a girl and a boy. Can we make out whether a skeleton was that of a man or a woman? Sometimes people decide on the basis of what is found with the skeleton. For instance, if a skeleton is found with jewelry, it is sometimes thought to be that of a woman. However, there are problems with this. Often, men also wore ornaments. A better way of figuring out the sex of a skeleton is to look at the bone structure. The hip or the pelvic area of women is generally larger to enable childbearing. These distinctions are based on modern skeletal studies. Charak, who wrote a book on medicine known as the Charak Samhita, there he states that human body has 360 bones. This is much larger number than the 200 bones that are recognized in modern anatomy. Charak arrived at this figure by counting the teeth, joints and cartilage. How do you think he find out about the human body in such great detail? Okay, so when they found these skeleton, they had to decide by looking. So it was very easy to distinguish a child skeleton with that of a grown up person. But the skeleton system of a boy and a girl, it was little difficult. Initially, they distinguished by If the skeleton was having jewelry, they considered that it was of a woman. But then men also were in the habit of wearing jewelry. So we cannot say that it is the best way to distinguish. Then they came up with the conclusion that if the pelvic bones, they are larger, that means they are that skeleton is of a woman, considering that they have to bear children. So therefore, the pelvic structure is comparatively bigger than that of a male. Then they have talked about Charak Samhita. Charak is one of the famous, doctors of our ancient India. And he has written a book which is known as Charak Samhita. And in this, he has referred to the bones. He has said that it is around 360. But that means he has calculated the bones like that, included teeth, cartilage, etc. in the bones. So obviously we can say that he was he's considered to be one of the greatest person in the history who has gained so much of knowledge on medicine. Then, occupation at Enam Gao. Archaeologists have found seeds of wheat, barley, rice, pulses, millets, peas and sesame. Bones of number of animals, many bearing cut marks that show they may have been used as food, have also been found. So archaeologists have found the seeds of, you can see the number of seeds which they have found is wheat, barley, rice, pulses, millets, peas and sesame. That means total 7. Then they have recovered the bones of number of animals which had cut marks. That means they might have been using the flesh for eating purpose. These include cattle, buffalo, goat, sheep, dog, horse, ass, pig, sambar, spotted deer, black buck, antelope, hare, and mongoose. Besides birds, crocodiles, turtle, crab, and fish, there is evidence that fruits such as ber, amla, jamun, dates, and a variety of berries were collected. So all these things were present and these people might have been using it for eating purpose. Then use this evidence to list the possible occupation of people at Enam Gao. So that means they have been domesticating animal, they have been practicing agriculture. Yeah, so these occupations were there. Then elsewhere, find China in your atlas. Around 3,005 years ago, we find some of the first evidence of writing in China. These writings were on animal bones. These are called oracle bones because they were used to predict the future. Kings got scribes to write questions on the bones. Would they win battles? Would the harvest be good? Would they have some sons? The bones were then put into the fire and they cracked because of the heat. Then fortune teller studied these cracks and tried to predict the future. As you may expect, they sometimes made mistakes. These kings lived in palaces in cities. They amassed vast quantities of wealth, including large, elaborately decorated bronze vessels. However, they did not know the use of iron. So list one difference between the Rajas of Rig Veda and these kings. So one of the differences is that these kings, who lived in China, they lived in palaces, they had armies, they had lot of wealth. While kings of Rig Veda, they didn't live in palace, they didn't have huge armies, and they didn't collect the taxes. So what they did was that initially the writing was done on the bones, and that bone was put in the fire and with the questions written on it. And the king asked the fortune tellers, the people who predicted future, and with the cracking, because of the heat, the bone cracked. And those cracks were studied by these fortune tellers, and they told the king what will happen in the future. Obviously, it was this there were chances that they might be wrong. So that is all for today, class. I'll be sending you the question answers, which you will be doing in your notebooks. Thank you, class. Take care of yourselves.